get ready, Philly. We're coming your way, and it's going to be pretty soon. Now, you do have time to prepare. It's not until the end of July.
So you got a couple of weeks. You got a couple of weeks. Yep.
We're going to Philadelphia. Jamie's flying in.
I'm flying.
She's not driving or riding a bike from Nashville.
Not taking the rails. No.
Not riding the rails like some dusty hobo.
Not this time, at least.
No, but we're going to be at Tattooed Mom.
That's right.
It's a bar in Philadelphia.
Such a fun place.
It is a fun place. If you've never been there, go there. Yeah. First of all, go there to see us.
Yeah, we'll be there.
But
so
also just go there.
Yeah, check it out. It's a great venue spot. The restaurant, bar. It's...
We got food.
We got food.
They have
there
food there. And when you go, bring stickers with you to just put on every inch of the wall. Just put it on. It's like every wall is about 5 inches thick of just stickers, I think.
I think so, too.
I don't think they've ever painted the place. Mm-mm. It's Mm-mm. just stickers.
It's got a fun decor. Yeah.
Right. But we will be there on July 27th at 5:30.
Yeah. Yeah.
Upstairs.
In the upstairs.
And what are we going to be talking about, Jamie?
Is it a bird? No. Is it a plane?
I don't think so.
I don't think it's that. I think it's Supergirl.
If you thought she was going to say Superman, you're wrong.
No, it's the year of the woman. It's Supergirl. That's right. And Faye Dunaway is like evil in it. Yeah.
I mean, it's Faye Dunaway. You know.
Yeah. She's always.
What else is she going to be?
Yeah. She's always cranky in films, isn't she?
I don't know. I don't even know why I'm saying that. But of course she's evil. I don't think she's Supergirl.
No, that would have been an interesting take. But that's what we'll be wearing our red capes. I'm going to wear a red cape, maybe. You don't know.
Oh, please wear a red cape.
All right.
Please wear a red cape. Oh, and how much does this cost people? How much does it cost them to get in to watch us?
It's free. That's free.
We're not making a dime.
No, we're just there for entertainment. Like mm-hmm. a monkey or a chimpanzee at a circus. We are just there for the entertainment. I'm going to have a cape and a cigar. How do you like that?
Wow. Okay. All right. I mean, I don't think you're allowed to smoke in bars anymore. But okay. You know what? We'll see. We'll see what we can. If you're just chomping away at it and you're not trying to light it like some insane monkey who fills a kitchen with gas for some reason.
No, she filled the kitchen with gas.
I know. Okay. I know. We're getting off topic here.
Okay, sorry.
My plan was to play this before every episode, not just the Link one.
Oh, no, sorry.
But anyway, so we will be there. Mark your calendars. If you are in the city, if you're within driving distance,
come on down.
Come see us. It was a lot of fun last time.
Yeah.
We hung up for what? 37 hours afterwards?
Yeah, it was a really fun. And then the whole festival is just a fun festival of podcast mania.
We should mention that it's part of the Philadelphia Podcast Festival. Yes.
Yeah.
It's not just us showing up with microphones at a bar.
We'll be there with beers talking about Supergirl. So
right, yes.
you should
come. What, though? If you own a bar or work at a bar and you're cool with that, let us know. We'll just show up anywhere.
Yeah.
Anywhere you work. Do you work at Macy's? Is there a corner that's free?
Like a street corner that's free now? Like a hot dog vendor? What do you I like? Mean, or a corner of the Macy's? Is that what you're saying?
I see. Yeah, the corner of the Macy's. I don't know. Is there a kiosk available, I guess? Is there an old abandoned sunglass hut at a mall somewhere that isn't being used?
Space doesn't matter to us. We'll be there. We'll bring laptops. We'll bring mics. Yeah. Actually,
so
they
we'll
give us mics at the festival.
We'll go anywhere, but we're going to be Tattooed Mom's. And that, again, is on July 27th at 5:30.
Wow.
Show up. Go upstairs. You know, I mean, they closed the door behind you, but you can come and go.
The bathroom was in there, I think. So if you've got to use the restroom.
Oh, yeah. If you wander in, like if you're a Tattooed Mom's at like 6 and you kind of forgot we were there And if you walk in to use the bathroom and you see us, stick around.
Yeah, listen up. Maybe give a chuckle or two if we say something.
Do they
amusing.
Really have a bathroom there?
I do remember using the bathroom right away after. I'm guessing it couldn't have been.
You're right. Yeah. Nope, they have bathrooms in there. Okay, yeah. So don't be afraid. We're on for an hour, so don't be afraid about having to use the bathroom. Like, don't let
it's
that
easily
deter
accessible.
You.
I might use mm-hmm. the bathroom during the episode.
If you have
you
IBS,
know.
Come on. Don't worry about
it. Doesn't matter.
It. Yeah. It's not a big
we
deal.
We welcome it.
It's not a distraction. All right, everybody, we'll see you then. And I assume we'll see everybody then. So come
on. We'll be there.
The end.
All right.
More or less racist than 16 candles? I don't know. You be the judge. Jamie.
Yep.
Let's go watch Gung Ho.
And welcome to another episode of Good Times, Great Movies. We come together every now and again, 2 weeks or so to be exact, to talk about a movie from the 1980s. It is me, Jamie Lorello, and the other guy here is DP McCambridge. Mm-hmm. Here from a couple hours away from Pittsburgh, right?
Yeah,
but born
five.
Born in Pittsburgh?
Yes.
Yes.
Born in Pittsburgh, yes. Now living near Philadelphia.
Living near Philadelphia, yeah. Uh-huh. Yeah, so coming home with this film, yeah. In a
coming
sense.
Home. Coming home to the dirty Pittsburgh suburbs of the mid-80s.
Oh, but Pittsburgh's on the rise now, right? Like, in the 80s, it was maybe a little, but isn't it kind of getting that revamping happening? Or hasn't it had that revamp sort of happen?
Yeah, it's one of those, like, okay, well, the steel mills aren't coming back, so now let's invest in technology and the city's a lot cleaner than it used to be.
Mm-hmm.
I think most of those old towns are that way, or at least that's what people say. That's what I hear about Cleveland is that, oh, Cleveland's kind of nice
up
now.
Up and coming, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, I think Drew Carey told me that, though, but I don't know if I should believe him. I think Detroit is still a joke, but all those Rust Belt kind of cities, like, I think in the 70s through the 80s, I think they all had a lot of decisions to make. Like, what are we doing here?
Yeah.
And this movie makes it seem very easy. Just beg Japan for help and they'll help you. Even
and they
after
will.
A terrible presentation.
Oh, not a good one at all. I mean, what was that?
What made them show up? What about that presentation made them go, you know what, this seems like a good investment?
I'm assuming how desperate he came off. I think they thought that with the that's how I took it was like he played the desperate card, not meaning to, thinking he was playing mm-hmm. the humble, honest card. And I don't know. I'm not inside the mind of a Japanese car
businessman.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Inside the mind of a Japanese car. They're pretty smart, all those computers in there.
Oh, by the way, these cars that they end up building look like they're like shitty cars.
They are garbage machines.
Yeah.
Those things are so tiny.
I felt
boxy.
So bad that they were working so hard on these, like, and they're like, work hard and make them excellent. Da, da, da. Yeah. And I was like, but they're shitty cars. What? But
terrible
there's a lot
cars.
Of them. There's a lot of them.
I mean, a lot of awful cars in the 80s, and they're all parked in this movie.
Yeah, they are. I don't think Donald Trump likes this movie very much. I'm just going to say that. Not that we bring politics into our
you don't think
podcast.
He likes this movie?
No, I don't think he does.
Why would you say that?
Because isn't he all about make America great again? So why would he be okay with Michael Keaton going to Japan to get?
I know, but he's also super racist. Like,
true.
He probably does love that about this movie.
True.
I guarantee you he doesn't even know that this is a movie.
Anyway, I don't want to poison our podcast with talk of the POTUS. Sorry.
Right, yeah. If you want to listen to us poison this podcast, Become a patron and listen to the first 15 minutes of this episode that I cut. Much like Donald Trump, I was not aware of this movie. Not really. I heard the term gung-ho, and I think I attached it to a movie. I know I'd never seen this before.
No, me neither.
But I feel like I may have heard of it. Mm-hmm. Had you even heard of it?
I feel like I did. Yeah, I feel like I had heard of it, and I feel like I knew it was Michael Keaton and Japanese.
I don't know if you need to say it like that. You said it as a word that you've only ever read and have never said out loud before.
It'll get better as we go on.
All right. Okay. Yeah. Did you know that this was made into a TV show afterwards?
Oh, where they, like, they're in the factory and then...
Yeah, yeah, it was made into a TV show. It was a mid-season replacement for another show that was canceled. It only lasted 9 episodes. And Scott Bakula, Quantum Leap Scott Bakula, played the Michael Keaton role.
I guess they were trying to hone in on middle-class America and how they feel and maybe some race relations. And
also, this movie was a hit.
People loved it.
People loved it. It was made for 13. We don't normally talk money on this, but I was very surprised.
Let's talk cash.
$13 million, and it made 36.
Wow.
Pretty big hit.
I guess, was there a height of Michael Keaton's career? This was definitely in sort of his upswing in his career. And I enjoy him. And I think, like you said, I think people find him because he's got these... he's got these Michael Keatonisms, I guess. Mm-hmm. People find him, if not enjoyable, at least comfortable to watch.
So this movie is called Gung Ho.
The start of this movie was hilarious. It's just screaming. They're just screaming. Again, yes. I wrote screaming Asians in my notes, and that's not what they are.
Yeah. And also, just because it's in your notes doesn't mean you need to say it out loud.
I know. Okay.
I would hope that Ron Howard and his team, whoever his team was that made this movie, did a lot of research.
Yeah.
And I would hope they're not just making this up, because it seems insane. But
with this training that these guys have to go through?
The beginning of this movie... Watanabe, what is his name? Kaz.
He calls him
Kaz. Okay. Yeah. Yes. So Kaz, it's short for something, which I didn't write down. He's getting screamed at. He's also screaming and yelling. He's got all these ribbons pinned to him as well. He's in a room and they're all just screaming. They're getting whipped and
They're getting whipped. I was like, this is intense. What are they doing?
Yeah.
And in the meantime, Michael Keaton, whose name I didn't find out till the very end. It's like Hunter or something like that. They don't say it, I don't think, till the end.
Yeah, when they brought him up at that 4th of July shame celebration, it was like, well, come on up here, Hunt.
I'm
like,
that's the first time I heard anybody say his name.
Glad you said the same thing, because I wrote it in my notes then going, boy, I must have missed this the whole time.
No, I didn't hear that. Even when he gets into places, I don't remember him introducing himself. But he is in his town, his hometown of Pittsburgh, and it seems that the whole town is relying on him to do something big. They're all like, we're counting on you.
Yeah, it's a weird beginning, because at first I thought maybe he's been pulled over for some DUIs or something, because he has to get in Mimi Rogers' car and she's driving him. I'm like, she's driving him to work. This is a weird relationship these two have.
Yeah.
Yes. And I don't think they live in Pittsburgh. I think it's a suburb. I think it's a small town outside, because he does make reference to, remember when we had to go into Pittsburgh and we had to play their team and I was the greatest basketball player? And then they showed all these guys, most of whom looked like better basketball players than he did. You're the star player, really? Was George Went on that team? Is that why you were the star player? You were like the Michael J. Fox compared to what Francis was on the Teen Wolf basketball team.
Yeah.
So anyway, we find out he's being driven to the airport because the factory, and we find out all this exposition a little bit later on. Mm-hmm. The factory in this town, the only place of employment, actually there were two. One was an underwear factory.
Yeah, I do find that.
They talk about underwear several times in this
movie. Yeah, the wet underwear. Yeah.
Wet underwear, yeah. I love it when Kaz is like, I kind of like it.
Yeah, I'm kind of into it. Yeah.
There was an underwear plant that went belly up.
Yeah.
And then there was a car factory.
Mm-hmm.
So nobody in this town works, I guess. Pretty
well, because they all worked at the car factory.
Right, exactly.
Or the underwear, and the underwear places went under, and now...
And you hear about places like this. Like, you hear about towns, and a lot of it is in Michigan. Like, oh, they closed this plant, and then that's when you realize, wow, that's where everybody worked. Or
all these families are affected by it, yeah.
Or coal mines and stuff like that. Like, it's the same thing.
Mm-hmm.
So... He flies out to Japan. I guess he flies into Tokyo.
Yep.
To go to a company, mm-hmm. a big car company, which, I mean, there's no backstory. Like, why is he targeting this company? Do you know what I mean?
Oh, we don't get to know that. I guess because they're very good at making shitty cars. I don't know.
Well, okay. Okay. I'm just saying, I know it has to be Japan. Like, I get it. For this movie, but why didn't he just fly up to Detroit or something like that and talk to Ford Motors or something like that? You know,
yeah.
But he has to go into Japan, and you know, it's a whole montage. We see him sleeping in a little tiny,
he's in like this pod
cubicle.
Thing.
Yeah,
we get a fun little montage of him in Japan, kind of running around trying to talk to the Japanese and. Not butchering their language and using a lot of hand, and then complaining to another one about not being understood and riding a bike with one guy, I think.
He does walk into the Yelling and Screaming Academy.
Yes.
Let's just call it that.
That's a good name for it, yeah.
And it is, like, he's really funny. Like, he is a really great comic actor when he comes in and disrupts all this, just asking for directions.
I didn't mean to interrupt your screaming.
When he tries to wipe spit off of Kaz's face, it's pretty great.
Well, because he does, he's got spit all in the corners of his mouth, and he's just yelling, and he's got these ribbon, and he's shouting in Japanese, and... saying all this stuff.
Yeah.
I love it. He's got a lot of little scenes where he just shouts. And they don't always use, I was going to say hieroglyphics. I don't know why.
Oh, but boy.
They don't always use subtitles or hieroglyphics for that matter. So.
Wouldn't that be something if that was an option on your DVD player?
Yeah, this one I'd like a little more hieroglyphics.
Right?
That's right.
They talk for 10 minutes and you're like, hey, just a picture of a bird? That means all of that? The Egyptians were so advanced.
Anyway, they're not hieroglyphics. They don't always they don't always give you the subtitles for. So there's a lot of times when he's just screaming in Japanese and mm-hmm. like waving his arms around and just screaming things. Like when he runs into the lake at the end and he's like, ah, da, da. Anyway.
I do love it when he looks at him and he goes, I like all those ribbons all over your outfit. And the guy behind me is like, those are ribbons of shame.
But I like it because they were explained then. I was like, what the hell's with all the ribbons
yes.
on them?
What
are these
That's
ribbon
what I thought
guys
too.
Doing?
Because in our country, if you get a ribbon, it means
it's a
you
winner.
Did something
yeah.
right.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. And I even thought, I was like, boy, these guys must be great at their job or something. And this intense training must be yielding great results. They all have these ribbons.
I just thought maybe they weren't the first place ribbons. That's, I don't know. And then he's told that this is not the meeting he wants to go to, even though in later he does. That's why I was confused. When Kaz first comes off the plane and comes to America, I was like, wait a minute, is this a joke?
Because I was very confused.
Right? Because they almost make it seem like this is not the place they do say that this is not the place that Michael Keaton's supposed to be. He's got the meeting down the hall. So you wonder, well, did he just walk into some terrible training?
Right.
And then later is one of the dudes from the terrible training like pretending to come? That's what I thought at first. He was pretending to come and take over this car factory, but he really is from. Last long in my mind. Cause
that would be kind of fun. Well, I thought for a little while that he was so bad that they sent him here. Like, that they sent Michael
Keaton,
the
that
most
too.
Incompetent moron at their company, because who cares? but it's just, he's just not as good at his job as everybody else is. I don't know. He's still better than most of the Americans, like, at his job, but I don't know if they sent him here to fail or what.
Yeah, I know. I think that it was, I don't know. I'm guessing that it was maybe to prove himself.
Okay.
But almost setting him up for failure because they send him with that slimy cousin.
Yeah, it's weird because in the end we find out that the big boss is actually kind of a cool guy. Like, yeah, it's like, all right, well, wait, has he always been a cool guy? Well, why is everyone afraid of him? And it just took the clumsy buffoonery of Michael Keaton to bring the fun out of this.
That's
boss?
What he needed. He needed that humor. One thing,
like, that why he sent Kaz in the first place? Like, from this terrible meeting that Michael Keaton had, he's like, this guy's pretty funny. Okay, we're going to do business with them.
Yeah.
Like, I don't know. It's bizarre that they ever even went along with this in the first place. Like, I almost want it to be something where Michael Keaton comes in and gives this amazing presentation that is a total lie, like putting up pictures of a town that is not this town.
Well, let's talk about his presentation, though, because first of all, he comes in and he's got this, like, what is he carrying with him?
It's like
to
a
do his
big
presentation?
Screen. It's like, yeah, a big screen to pull down.
But he doesn't need that. And I love that he comments and he's like, yeah, I only dragged it like all the way across the country and then all over the freaking town to bring it here. And now we don't even need it. But whatever.
Yeah, he says something like, oh, it's no big deal. I only brought it 14,000 miles, yeah, or something.
Because they've got, you know, some high tech electronics in their office. Things, screens are talking to them. He does still put on a little slideshow for them. And like this third slide in is just like a woman in cleavage. And
what
he's
is that?
Trying to
Yeah.
I love it.
What is that?
He's trying to make some joke about her putting out or something.
Okay. Here's the thing. I know that's just a joke. But the thing I kept coming back to is that weird mysterious blonde lady that
the one,
seems to actually be a part of this movie?
Heather DiStefano?
Right? Yeah, I was like, oh, did Heather work at this company?
No, I don't think it's the same. I don't think it was the same.
So you
woman.
Think it's just a stock
I
image
I think it's
of
just a stock image of it. Because,
He's cracking jokes, and it's great in that he's getting no response.
And he's making a point of, he's like, oh, what do you guys got? A long day of staring ahead of you? Right. Is that what you guys have planned for the day? Because there, no one's even giving him a little bit of head nod. They're giving him nothing. And he falls really flat when he does this presentation and tries this little, like, woman joke. That doesn't work for him. So then he puts down, he closes up the slideshow, and he's just going to speak from the heart. And he basically just tells them that the whole town, he explains the whole underwear factory that went under and that the town now is just the car factory. Like I said, he does this sort of humble and honest, desperate speech. And then he goes back. Next thing we know, he's like back in the States and he's just all, I love it when he does see his girlfriend again and he's all over her, like all over her. And he's
all
like, I've missed you so much. And she's like, that's nice. That's her response.
Like, oh, great. Okay. And I was even thinking, how long has he been gone? Like, has he been gone for a month? Like,
he feels so lonely. And you see when he's trying to communicate with people. Anyway, yeah.
Yeah, but we don't see a lot of that. This all appears to have been a single day. Like, he woke up in that future pod and then had his meeting and then flew back. Like, that's what it felt like to me.
But then he's bummed. He's bummed because he doesn't think that, you know, obviously they didn't sign any deals.
He's not bummed because he's trying to get out of this town. Because he's calling everybody known. There's some jokes how he calls a guy he went to kindergarten with. Oh, don't you remember me? We were in kindergarten together. Oh, no, not that guy. Not the one who ate paste all the time or whatever he says.
Yeah.
He's just trying to get a job somewhere else. He realizes that
well,
this didn't work.
And the whole town's going away. However long he was gone for, when he comes back and they're driving around, he's like, the pizza shop's closed down.
And Mimi Rogers is like, oh, yeah, that happened yesterday.
Yeah.
Because you've been gone for 48 hours.
Yeah. Things are closing down. The town's shutting down. But
He's excited as everybody is when he left. I'm amazed nobody's there when he gets off the plane.
Nobody questions. No, they don't care. They don't care. It's like they know things are bad.
He appears to have gone home, has been making phone calls. He's climbing all over Mimi Rogers in the car. No, George Wendt doesn't even check up on him.
Well, they do end up having beers together. That's when they have the infamous Heather DiStefano sighting, this random girl that the whole town is crazy for that we don't ever even see again.
What is this?
He makes mention of her.
It is just so he and Mimi Rogers have something to fight about. That's it. Because who is this well-to-do man who is walking her down alley Scumtown?
I don't know.
It is so strange. It doesn't make any sense.
And the way
they're
all these like factory men drinking beer, and she comes by and they behave like a bunch of high school dudes. They're like, oh my God, she says hello to you?
Yeah, and that's weird when he's like, hey, Heather, what? You say hello to her? I'm like, if she heard that, she's hearing all of this.
All of it,
right there. And George Wendt, are you holding a basketball? Are you really about to play basketball?
What's happening here?
I want to see that. Because even when he power walks later in this movie, did you see that scene where he's like charging up the
when they're coming back to
cars,
make the...
I'm like, you shouldn't move this fast. It looks bizarre.
Yeah, it does. It does. It looks dangerous.
He finds out that the Japanese are coming, that they're coming to reopen the plant. Mm-hmm. They bought this plant. Everybody's going back to work. It's a big thing. Yeah. The whole town turns out on the tarmac of this airport to greet them.
And I love it. They've got the movie theater red carpet they pull out.
Yep.
They have a dragon. They have kids dressed as a... And again, is that a Japanese thing or is that a Chinese dragon?
Is that from their culture?
Mm. And they have kids in karate outfits.
Yeah, I think we're meant to think it's Chinese because that makes it funnier.
Yeah.
I love how there's like six women just dressed in kimonos standing there too.
Did you hear? When the kids are standing there in their karate outfits, whoever's wrangling them is like, do you want me to get the fire hose on you guys? Did you hear that?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah. And it's great because it is just like this children's... It's like a children's karate class.
So they come and the mayor introduces himself, this dopey mayor that spits all over them, I guess, when he and she's like, sorry, I spit when I get nervous.
I'm sorry, when I say my name, quickly I spit on people.
You've had your whole life to say your name, dude. You should really work on that.
All these characters who have no point and no purpose in this movie.
But we gotta know that the town is,
No, I understand. The Japanese guys that are in charge, they're always wearing lab coats. There's, five or six of them?
Yeah.
One is the bad guy. Let's just call him the bad guy.
With the hair, yeah.
And then there's the guy from 16 Candles, and then just the rest.
The guy that has the dance routine at the end? Whose wife has a baby.
Oh, that guy. Yes.
Yeah,
okay,
he's pretty fun.
He's the only other one who kind of has a personality. He's around from time to time. They want to give Michael Keaton a new job.
Yes.
As employee liaison.
Yes.
So, they give him this new employee handbook. And they're like, oh, just make sure you can make sure your guys know all this stuff. Or this is the way we're going to do it now. And even he's like, well, what's... we ran this company apparently into the ground with the way we did it last time.
Why don't we just keep doing this?
Mm-hmm. So they're like, no, that's not the way it works. We're going to run it like a Japanese company. Hilarity ensues. And not really. Like, I thought this movie was a comedy. It's way more of a drama than a comedy.
It has moments. It says it's poignant moments. Yes.
Oh, I thought you meant comedic moments. I was going to say.
Oh, no.
Most of it's like a drama wrapped up with a little bit of comedy from time to time. I found. I just didn't think it was as hilarious and slapstick funny as I thought
it was. It wasn't like
a
knee slapper funny.
Right. Okay.
But again, I think it was a Keaton's performance. And then, too, Kaz's, even his performance at times. But yes, it definitely had more dramatic elements and twists.
When they give him a lot to do, like at the bowling alley, I loved it.
When he's drunk at the bowling alley. Yeah.
Yes. Uh-huh. I thought he was amazing when they gave him stuff to do rather than just when he was in a room with Michael Keaton so Keaton could be funny, which is a lot of this movie.
We're in the water together. Keaton, so they give him the job.
Yes.
And I think his response was, he says something like, would I take the job? Is the frog's ass watertight?
Yep.
And the whole
discussion that they have to have about
this. It's a whole big thing
.
That the Japanese guys chatter about, again, without subtitles, so we don't know what they're saying. But that's okay. And then there's a union meeting that happens.
Yes.
Are they going to get these jobs back? How much pay are they going to get for these jobs? And Keaton finds himself rallying everyone at this union meeting with his epic basketball story. Because like you said, he was the basketball high school champ. And the town loves it. They go crazy for it. And the next day, they love this basketball story.
Can we talk about before this, the union leader gets up? This guy looks so disheveled. Like, I came up when I heard about this. His briefcase isn't even closed. His paper's out. His tie's all loose. It's like he was in a fight in the parking lot and came in. And they boo him off stage so that Keaton can get up and talk about the state championship.
But
he's the greatest basketball player this town has ever seen.
Well, and he makes mention of how the basketball game went down and how they were the underdogs and he brought them back, and you have to play all quarters of the game and we're going to have to play a little bit of their game so that we could do our game too. But he's able to really get them excited.
And I think that's why, and we were talking about this before we started recording, or before the show started, we were talking about this to the patrons about, he's an actor that seems like this is the type of guy that he is.
Yeah.
That he can be very convincing, and that he can sort of trick himself into thinking, well, I have everybody's best intention here. I'm just doing what's right for them and what's right for them, and I'll figure it out later, and I can be as personable as possible, and everyone believes me. He never thinks he's doing anything wrong in this movie, but he's doing everything wrong. You know, and I think that that's just the type of person he is. And it's not even as though he knows he's doing things wrong. He just gets himself into bad situations because he's such a nice guy and wants to be liked by everyone.
Wants to be liked.
Yeah.
Wants to be the likable guy.
Right. This is why I did think that this is why I could never be a boss or be in charge. I would be a lot like this. I wouldn't really feel comfortable telling people what to do. I never want to give people bad news. Like, that is not the type of person I am. I would never want to be put in this situation.
So you would have declined the job had the Japanese offer.
No, I would have done just what he did, because I would have taken it, because I'd be like, oh, this is like a huge pay raise, and I'd probably be pretty good at this. Yeah. But I would get in just as much trouble as he would, because I'd have, I don't know, when he has to get back up in front of them and he starts, like,
when he gets himself in that web of lies, he's like,
So do we get a partial raise for 13? He's like, yeah, but let's not think about that. Let's focus on the 15.
I think it's so funny, too. I get it that is a lot more cars. But if you can make it to one number, why not push it for the other? And he doesn't take the right angle. He doesn't. I mean, he starts to say we could do better than them, and that's what we should do. But he doesn't push that angle enough. And he should have.
Right. Because I was even at one point like, well, you guys are at 13,000.
Yeah, why don't you
just finish
it out? How can
you not make it to 15? Especially because you walked out for, I don't know how many days. You could have made it to 20,000.
Well, and then in a day, they do the extra that they needed to do. And I'm like, guys, where was all this oomph and energy before? You had to take a bunch of days off and feel sad about your town and make Michael Keaton feel all
there bad? There were times in this movie where I had legit laughs. And when he and Kaz are walking in there and the guys are like, you're going to make 1,000 cars in one day? And he turns around and goes, yeah, we're going to skip lunch. I thought that was really funny. But anyway, he's talking about an old high school basketball story. He's like a regular Al Bundy. And he convinces them that it's no big deal with these Japanese guys. He's got it. He knows how to talk to them. Not to worry at all.
Right.
Also, as is the case with all Ron Howard movies, his crazy brother's in this movie wearing, like, a Pittsburgh Pirates batting helmet all the time.
Oh.
What is he doing? What is that look? He's always in that batting helmet.
Because he's just ready to play ball anytime.
Clint Howard, also, I thought this was fun. Most of the Japanese actors were in the TV show. Clint Howard, the only American to go into the TV show.
Oh, yeah? No joke. All right. There you have it.
So day one, they're already in trouble because they're doing exercises in the morning.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. And first they're excited. They've got their uniforms. They're working. They're happy the factory's back open. But then the Japanese try to do a leading round of jumping jacks. And first it's not happening. And then Michael Keaton realizes, okay, this is where I got to step it up, do my job. And for a minute, they all are doing a duck hop and a knee twist. It's very, very weird.
But then it becomes a big joke.
And I like his comparison when he tries to motivate them. Again, he goes back to high school analogies, and he says, it's like in school when they tell you you can't wear jeans on the first day, but then you give them a couple of weeks, and before you know it, you could wear jeans to school. So we just got to do this for a little bit, and then they're not going to make us do this anymore.
And this is the point in the movie where I was like, Michael Keaton, did you read that employee manual that they gave you? Because I don't think you did.
No, he didn't.
He seems surprised by everything that's happening.
His whole feeling was that, like, well, we've done this before. We'll just do it. I do like, so after the exercise debacle, things seem to be running smoothly enough for a little bit of a montage to the song Tough Enough.
Yeah, but even this is kind of just a montage of the Americans making fun of the Japanese guys. Like, they're eating their lunch with chopsticks and stuff. But the Japanese guys are installing, you know, closed circuit TV cameras and stuff all around. And they're telling them they can't listen to music while they're working.
Right. No music. No smoking cigars. I don't know that you should smoke cigars when you're putting together cars anyway, but
I don't know, Jamie. It's the 80s and it's the auto industry.
That's true.
Who cares? George Wendt isn't putting anything together properly.
No, I know. I like when the Asian man's like, you can't go. Oh, the Asian. I did it. Dang.
It's all right.
The Japanese man is like, maybe I shouldn't point it out when I do it. Maybe that'll be better. All right. Anyway, he's pointing out, like, you don't go this way, this way, this way. You go boom, 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 boom.
Yeah.
Because he's got no
George
method
like,
to his
well,
madness.
What's the difference? I'm like, okay, calm down. Because he flies off the handle at the drop of a hat.
I like it because Norm, as I know him, is like such a likable guy, right?
Yes.
In Cheers. But in here, he's kind of a jerk.
Villain. And I was like, I think he had some preconceived notions about the Japanese before they showed up that he's bringing to this.
Yes, yes. He plays like a arrogant jerk.
Yeah.
And he does it well. Because I'm not a fan of
when he's harassing the guy's wife in the grocery store. It's like,
not nice.
You're taking this to a new level now.
Like, well, when he runs into him at the baseball game, how about that?
Yes. And also, I don't follow sports the way I used to, but I do know that he's out and that the Japanese team won that game because that's a penalty. You can't do that.
Yeah, no, you can't just knock somebody on
their
feet
foul.
Like that.
And I do love how no one else gets excited like he does.
So yeah.
Everybody else is like, no.
They all kind of realize, you kind of take it too far there, Norm.
Oh, God. I hate it when Michael Keaton calls the receptionist sugar puss.
Oh, yeah.
I was like, you're one word away from Mel Gibson here. If he just went sugar tits, I'd be like, oh, no, Mel Gibson's in this movie. And it is the 80s, and Mel Gibson probably thought that was fine because, much like George Wendt later, he's drunk all the time. So, what are you going to do? Also at this time, Michael Keaton, like, his whole thing is he's on the floor with his factory worker buddies, his friends and neighbors.
Yeah.
And they're telling him one thing. And then his job.
Yeah.
His job is supposed to be. Here's the problem. His job is supposed to be to listen to what Kaz has to say and to relay that to the workers.
Right.
But more times, he's listening to what the workers say and relaying that to Kaz. And I know that his job is supposed to be both.
Right.
But just when he sits down with them and he's like, oh, no. A lot of cars have defects and there's no problem with that. All of that sounds terrible.
They really don't seem to take the fact that they are building, like, even when they're building all those 15,000 cars and they get the last bit in, and he's like, and you know what? It's okay if the last few don't have certain things on it. It's fine.
Yeah.
It's just, and but that's not fine. No, like, it's these not are fine. Features that have to. But his feeling is like, yeah, exactly. Like, yeah, every car can't be perfect.
He even
so, yeah,
says
some
to
of
the
our
one
cars
guy
are
at the
great.
End of the movie, he's like, no, just push it in place. We can bolt it tomorrow.
Yeah, don't, yeah. It's okay. Exactly.
And then he's just an idiot for getting in one of those cars and trying to drive it.
I do love that, though. I do
that,
love it.
That was pretty funny.
And I love how it's all like, oh, is it going to start? It starts. But yep. then, like, literally, I like that he falls backwards. It's great.
I also laughed when the guy opens the hood of the car and the one guy's
and he's inside
there.
Of it. Yeah.
That guy who they're really encouraging him to read, which I thought was a great part of this movie.
Okay.
It was like, oh, they're encouraged. He's like,
he's
oh,
also
yeah,
the guy that injures himself.
Yes. Yes. Yeah. Oh, no, it's okay if he takes that newspaper in the bathroom. We
like
him
to read.
Encouraging
him
to read.
Yeah. Yeah. So the Japanese have a lot of rules. There's
yes.
a lot of fires he's putting out because whether he read the manual or not, he's kind of just thinking, well, we'll do our jobs and you guys just lead us and I'll just make sure they're doing their jobs. But part of them doing their jobs is the Americans want to take time off when their kids have dance recitals or graduations or whatever, mm-hmm. and they want to read and smoke cigars and listen to music. And the Japanese people, that's not how they work. They say there a lot that they work as a team.
Yes.
That they'll stay late to get everything done. That not one man is going to be the best at anything. They all do everything.
And you should get pleasure out of your work. That
right.
Your work should be your pleasure. You should work as a group. I love it near the end of this one. He's like, you people don't even know how to work as a team. You're all too busy getting personalized license plates.
Yeah, personalized license plates.
So they have the big baseball game where the Japanese have uniforms. They have uniforms, which is amazing.
Yeah,
I do like
amazing.
When George Wendt goes, oh, they're even dressed like the Yankees. I hate them already,
yeah.
which is funny. and the Japanese come up and they start bunting, which then George Wendt moves in and then they hit the ball over his head.
Yeah.
I really thought it was going to just be the Japanese team destroying them, but it's a pretty close game.
Yeah, yeah.
And as you said, it comes down to the last hit and George Wendt knocks the dude over.
Yeah. This baseball montage did last a little
it
long for me. Like,
way
I got
long.
Up and got some more beverage because I was like, all right, when this best baseball thing is over, it's obviously going to be an intense ending to the game. And then, yeah, Norm knocks the guy down and nobody's really happy. And then Michael Keaton has these moments, and this was one of them, where he, like, looks desperately off and
oh,
like, worried
God.
And concerned.
Yep.
Like, he knows. And then Kaz looks back at him like, yeah, man, yeah, this could have been great, and now it's not. Because that's the thing. What sparks the baseball game is Michael Keaton's trying to talk to Kaz like, hey, you got to just let my guys do my
yeah.
their thing. And Kaz is kind of like, well, we are running this company, so this is
right.
how we have to do it. And Michael Keaton's like, well, let's do something fun. What do you like to do for fun? Do you guys like to play ball? We have
right.
a ball game
yes.
coming up.
That's what a lot of this movie is. A lot of it is the Japanese guys saying, you don't know how to work, and the American guys saying, you don't know how to relax. That's
yeah.
really what
that's,
this movie
yeah.
is.
That's the core, yeah.
So we get a brief glimpse into Kaz's home life.
Oh, right, right.
He's working a lot at home. His wife's arguing with him. She bought a bike for their kids from Sears. She wants
yeah.
him to put it together.
Mm-hmm.
And this is when the phone rings, and you hear him talking to the big boss guy
mm-hmm.
about how production has not gone up since he's arrived. It actually
right.
has gone down.
Right.
And that's a big issue.
Yeah.
And the next day, maybe they're taking it on George Wendt because of what he did in the baseball game, but he gets bumped down to custodial duty.
He gets handed a broom. He's excited, too. They call
it's,
him out, and
he thinks he's getting a promotion.
Yeah, and it's all the gangs around.
The baseball game happened, what, 12 hours ago? How do you think you're getting a promotion at
Why
that
do
time?
You think that this is your time to shine? And all his buddies think so, too. They're like, yeah, yeah, and then he's more... This is a sweet moment, too, because he's very embarrassed now and doesn't know what to do. And again, Michael Keaton comes in. This is a good boss move. You're saying sometimes he's not the
mm-hmm.
best boss. Well, this was a good boss move because he kind of tells him, like, you know, well, basically you need a job. And
yes.
you what you need to do is just keep your chin up and don't look at him. He's all embarrassed. And he's like, just
right.
don't look. It's not none of their business. You have a family
yeah.
to take care of. So just get your broom and do what you got to do.
Sure.
And then he yells at everybody, get back to work, get back to work. Then they have the dinner next.
Oh, they have dinner. They have the meatloaf. Dinner, and isn't that a part of this movie? It is a funny exchange when he asks what it is. And she says it's meatloaf, and she's like, you didn't know it was meatloaf? And he's like, I didn't know because I've never had meatloaf this good before.
And then he says he wants to share it. He's like, my girlfriend was asking if she could have it. I won't deny her it because it's so good. And he could
have
it.
How can I say no? And just dumps it on her plate. It is pretty funny. Then the men have to talk business, and all of the Japanese ladies get up and leave, and Mimi Rogers is like, no, I'm kind of into this.
Yeah, I kind of want to know. I manage a store. I mean, that's just the same as managing a car company. But I do like how she does want to stay because she wants to know what's going on, and then she gets an ins, well, until Michael Keaton tells her to shut up, and she gets really mad. He's trying to do his thing. He should have said shut up to her for sure, but at the same time...
He's backed into a corner here because they're like, yeah, you're fired because the guys aren't working hard. Like,
you're not doing what we asked to do.
You're not telling them what we're asking. He does say you're acting like a bunch of Yokohama mamas, which is a weird thing to say.
He's like, shit, now I've been fired and now my girlfriend walked out on me. But then next thing you know, these Japanese men are like, bathing together in the Pittsburgh River, I'm going to call it. I don't know.
Just call it the Pittsburgh
River.
What's
the river out there? What is the river out that way?
There's the Allegheny River.
All right.
There's the Monongahela River.
Watch your mouth.
They both join up into the Ohio River, but there's a lot of rivers because there's a lot of bridges. I don't know what
I'll call it the Allegheny. They're bathing in the Allegheny, and all of a sudden with a little snorkel mask on... Kind of funny. Michael Keaton pops up on them and is like, hey, guys, listen. So
he pops up, he scares them, which is really funny.
He's like, I know that y'all wanted to fire me, but so he wheels and deals with them and basically makes this deal that in the next month he says, I bet my guys could make, you know, just as many cars as you guys make in a month, easy. And they're like, well, 15,000. He's like, they'll do it.
Do like his reaction to that. What are the most cars you made in a month? 15,000. He's like, oh my God, what? Oh yeah, we could do that. I also like it when they're like, how long have you been here? He's like, oh, I've been under there the whole time.
And I like it because he's got a snorkel, but the piece isn't hanging up. So how has he been underwater?
Was he underwater waiting for them? Did he swim downstream?
I don't know.
So he says to them, listen, our guys aren't getting paid a lot. The union guys even told us at the beginning of this that, hey, you're getting ripped off royally.
Yeah.
And he says, hey, if we do 15,000 cars in a month, you got to bump up their pay and give them permanent jobs, which I don't, like, I didn't know that they were just, I don't know what I thought was going on. But anyway, that's all part of the deal. And, you know, the Japanese guys are like, sure, yeah, let's do this. Because, of course, and especially the evil guy, he doesn't think they're going to do it anyway. So why not? Like, this is going to be a huge failure for them, a huge failure for his rival, Kaz, I guess.
Yeah.
So now is when Michael Keaton does another one of his great speeches in, let's call it, Union Hall.
Good. Yes.
Where
he rallies him up again.
He uses reverse psychology. He's like, you know what? American workers are terrible. And everyone boos. He's like, yeah, I don't believe it either. Yeah. And then they all cheer.
And then they all go crazy.
It's really funny. And like we said earlier, he does say that they have to make 15,000 cars, and everybody's instantly quiet. I really love that reaction.
Yeah, I love how they're like, no.
We can't do that.
Yeah, they don't even want to try. They don't even get a little bit jazzed, and that's why I was surprised they don't bring the number down so low. Like, hey, we could do 5,000 or 10,000. They just bring it down by 2,000. They're like, well, what if we did 13,000 instead of 15,000? It's like, well, what if we got a B instead of an A?
Yeah.
Would you still get us, you know?
Right. And I'm like, if you think you can get 13.
Yeah, why don't you just push the extra?
Why don't you think you can get 15? Or if 13 doesn't seem like a big deal, how many were you? you making before? Because right. It seemed like they were making like...
What are your numbers?
Eight,
yeah, exactly. They did 12 a month and they were like, well, that's a lot. And even those weren't all perfect, as we know.
Right, yeah. Well, George went. He's sweeping now. So maybe the cars will run without falling apart. We don't know. You know, he even says stuff like, you'll get half of a raise if you get to 13. But you know what? Let's do the 15. It'll be great. Let's go. Yay. And he gets them all riled up again. And then there's a bit of a montage, like a brief montage of them staying late and showing up early. John Turturro even catches the morning paper, which I guess he's never out to do that.
No.
Then his workers start to give him a little bit of shit because he's like, you know, they're like, it's Sunday, we're working.
Right.
John Turturro hasn't seen his kids in 2 weeks. And it he's ain't really easy. Bummed out about that.
Mm-hmm. One thing I will say is that now I get it that these are long hours and it's not fun for these workers. But
sure.
Like even he points it out later on, Michael Keaton, like, without this factory, they don't have a job. They don't have anything. So wouldn't you just like say, all right, we could do this. We could do this so that way we can keep our jobs and the factory stays here. But it's like, it's very typical American where, and they even point that out in here where it's like, if I like self-care Sunday, I need it for my life to be okay.
I get it. It's a very weird attitude to be like, well, can I have like a half of a raise for almost doing it?
Yeah. If I get like pretty close, like, can I still get something?
Super entitled to something, right?
Right.
And even Michael Keaton is like, why are you taking a break? You've been taking a break for 5 months.
Yeah, that's he brings that up. Yeah.
Guys, you haven't been working. And we see early on in this movie that they are so excited to go back to work. Like they are so happy, over the moon to go back to work. Mm-hmm. And I understand, you probably shouldn't work, you know, 10 hours a day, 7 days a week.
You do need to see your family. Right. There needs to be a balance.
The payoff is to then get that raise and that permanent employment. Wouldn't you think that that's incentive enough, especially when they go, that's it, we're walking. Wait. Do you all collectively have that short-term memory where you don't remember that you didn't have jobs, I don't know, 5 weeks ago?
And that there won't be anything for you?
Right.
Michael Keaton was making calls in the beginning. There was nothing there. Nothing.
Maybe you didn't hear the pizza place is closed.
Yeah, exactly. You can't even be a pizza delivery man in this town because there ain't no pizza place to deliver from.
You know that pizza guy was like, damn it, I closed and now these people have money again to buy pizza. You know what, though? They're working through lunch. They don't have time to go get it. He could deliver the pizza.
Yes.
Don't you see... Ass Man Motors or whatever it's called. You're not just hurting the workers of the Ass Man Corporation. You're hurting the local businesses as well. The grocery store.
Yeah, the grocery store that sells cookies and cheese puffs and cat litter.
Yeah, this is the point of the movie where George Wendt is harassing Kaz's wife in the grocery store. It's just I don't know. It's just mean, man. Like,
yeah, he's just a jerk. He's like blocking her from getting something off the shelf and he's drunk. And then he has a fight.
I got no sense that he was drunk. And I do like him. How Michael Keaton walks up and goes, I know you're drunk and everything. What? It's just a normal Sunday afternoon for George Wendt.
Just being a jerk in the grocery store. They have a roll around fight at first, right?
Yes. But then it turns into punching.
Yeah, then he actually punches him into the cheesy puffs.
George Wendt hits him with a bag of cat litter at first. Funny.
And then he does feel bad. Michael Keaton feels just bad. He didn't want to do that. He's his friend. And what's this job and this whole thing coming to, you know?
But then in the next scene, you know, Michael Keaton and Kaz are talking. And Kaz is like, listen, my wife told me what you did for her. I appreciate that. And he's like, no, don't, please don't fire George Wendt. He's like, I won't fire him. He's a friend of yours. And this is when Michael Keaton comes clean about how he told his guys, or was that when they go drinking?
This is when they go drinking. That's okay. When he tells them.
Well, they go drinking
that
right now.
It is so fun.
He's like,
when
let's go have a beer.
Yeah. Let's go have a beer. Cause that's where in a small town you're going to get your beers, the bowling alley. And I love it. Kaz does this weird one your elephant dick joke?
What?
Where he puts his hand in his pants because he's so drunk and is like, look, what am I? And then Michael Keaton even makes fun and says, oh, we have a good raff instead of a good laugh. We're having a good raff. They're having a good time.
They really are. It's really, I think, the time in this movie where they just let these two do what they do, which are be quite funny, and mm-hmm. they play off of each other really well.
They do.
I love it when, Kaz is talking about how horrible he has it, and Michael Keaton's like, you think you have it bad? I told my guys that you were going to give them half a raise if they make 13. And Kaz is even like, oh, you're right. Michael Keaton's like, oh, my God. So you're going to do it? He's like, oh, no, you're right. You're in way more trouble than I am.
Yeah.
The guy in all this nonsense, like the next day, whatever, the guy who they try to encourage to read, he gets his hand all fucked up the car machinery.
So they're trying to, the workers are, for the American workers, are working harder probably than they have in the past 5 months. And they are trying to plow out a lot of cars. And in that, there's like one guy, doesn't the one guy want to go home and they don't let him? Or maybe that was earlier. Anyway, they're sacrificing a lot.
John Turturro wants to go home and see his kid, or his kid's having dental surgery or something. Tonsils taken out, right.
And they're sacrificing a lot. And so in this, our expert reader gets injured. He gets his hand caught. It's stop the machine. And now everybody's pissed because, this is what happens. When you're overworked, there's that balance, right? When you're overworked, then you're not paying as much attention or whatever happened. And he injured his hand. But even the Japanese guy, even Kaz, kind of is like, no, we have to, because the mean guy is like, get back to work. And Kaz is like, no, there's a man hurt here.
Yeah, Kaz pushes him down and is like, he's hurt. Come on, whatever.
Yeah, things are getting tense.
Things are getting very tense because the expert reader goes to the hospital and a few guys from work go there as well. The kind of chubby Japanese guys, he comes over with, I don't know, a gift basket or something like that.
Like a get well basket,
And this is when he spills the beans that, you guys aren't getting half a raise for 13.
There was no deal, yeah.
Right, I don't know what you're talking about.
And then they're pissed. And I love it that they call Michael Keaton. First of all, even before, it's just so 80s. You forget what it was like to hold a phone, Because even earlier when Michael Keaton's making all the calls to try to get a job, and he's like holding the phone in his hand.
Yeah, I regret that growing up, our phone was mounted on the wall, right? It was like mounted on the wall of the kitchen. Mm-hmm. And my grandmother had a rotary phone, but we never had a rotary in the house. Like, as far back as I can remember, we had a touch tone. I see people walk around with those rotary phones in movies. I'm like, I never got to experience that. It looks awesome.
It looks like fun. It must have been, I guess, my grandmother had one too in her little office, and it was just fun to...
Oh, I loved it. I had my grandmother's rotary phone forever. I don't know what happened. I think my kids finally broke it.
And you had the thing. It had like a handle part that you could pick it up and hold
like
it
from.
Yeah,
like in the back of it. Yeah. So they call him. And I did think that this was – the payoff is funny. But then I was like, that seems like a very threatening phone call. When they call him, John Turturro is like, hey, we found out about that raise. Okay. We're coming to get you. It's like, whoa, man. All right. And Michael Keaton does some hilarious,
packing up the fish. Yeah.
He's throwing things around. He's yelling at his fish. He's very upset about his ungrateful fish.
Well, because so I don't know where he was going. He was going to skip out of town because he thought they were all going to get him.
I don't know. But they are not coming to get him. Well, they're coming to get him. But they think that the Japanese backed out on the deal.
Yes.
They told him one thing, and they're going back on this deal, and they're so upset. But Michael Keaton's like, oh, you know what? You could go kick their asses, but a better idea is I'll go talk to them.
Yeah, let me go handle it. Yeah.
Right.
Now, this is where he gets himself tangled in a web that continues throughout the rest of the movie. This lie that that the Japanese went back on their deal, which didn't happen, but
now... At the same time... Sorry. Mm-hmm.
No, go ahead.
At the same time, things aren't going well for Taz.
Oh, yeah.
Because Mr. Sakamoto shows up?
At his house, and now His kids are becoming totally Americanized. He's not necessarily no more Twisted Sister, more Kool-Aid. He tells them
Twisted Sister. I love that.
Then even when the big boss arrives to his house and his son comes in and with army fatigues on and is shooting them,
and then starts yelling G.I. Joe.
Yes, and I love it. Kaz is like, "That's the neighbor's kid. It's not my kid." But now the boss is going to come into work the next day to see how everything's going. Also, Michael Keaton has the plan to and.
The boss isn't happy because he knows that they had some union meeting.
Yes.
And that's the whole reason why the boss comes down.
Because that nephew weasel is
giving him all the rat told him about it. So then, you know, Michael Keaton and Kaz have a little to-do in his office.
Like, oh, a to-do when they fight and they jump on the table and they jump on the chair and the table because they're fighting with each other.
Yeah.
They call him, is a Millie an offensive thing?
I don't know.
Okay. What? Because that's what he calls them. So they get into it a little bit. I think Michael Keaton calls Kaz a Millie. So they're fighting with each other and they get heated. This is kind of a funny scene too. And they're standing on chairs and they're both standing on his desk and they're yelling at each other. And I think it's Michael Keaton finally gets so mad he calls him a Millie.
Oh, I don't remember that.
I don't know. Well, then they have another fight.
Right away. It just spills out onto the floor. This one erupts in violence, though. They do start, like, punching
and rolling around. Yeah.
This is when George Wendt's like, he's just carrying that broom everywhere he goes.
Yeah, because that's what he is now. He's a janitor. He's
always got his broom. He's like, that's it. I don't know about you guys, but I've heard enough. I'm walking. And they all leave. Smash cut to, they're just having beers at a 4th of July celebration, loving life.
Some kind of 4th of July town celebration. Movie?
I don't know. This town dumps all their money into, I don't know, meeting people on the airport tarmac and this 4th of July celebration. Yep. For this dirt poor town, they're like, you know what? Fireworks? Check. Carnival rides? Yep, we got them. Lots of fun games to play? Mm-hmm. Just a keg of beer for no reason? Done. Let's go to the gazebo, everybody.
And then when we finally find out his full name is Hunt Stevenson,
I didn't know. This is the first time I wrote it in my notes, too.
Yeah, quite a celebration for this little sad little town.
It's crazy.
Half their workers just left the only job in town.
And they are living life. They don't care.
They just celebrate.
They don't have a care in the world. They've just left their job, and they're hoping for that half a raise because they're at 13. Actually, they even say we're 1,000 cars short. They're at 14,000 cars.
They're so close.
And they just couldn't. What, like several days left?
Mm-hmm. And they just quit. They just quit because on principle.
Lazy American workers.
You lazy American workers. No more Twisted Sister for you. This mayor is such a jerk because he's like, where is Hunt Steven? He calls him up and then he's like, I'm going to read this letter. And you're thinking maybe the letter is saying, like, you know, spreading some good news. And he reads a letter about how the Japanese company is leaving because the leader was the worst leader. And then the mayor's like, and I'm going to kill you. You killed our town, and now I'm going to kill you. And then maybe it's the reader guy. Somebody in the audience or the town is like, no, let's give him a chance. Don't we know that Hunt's just trying to do something for the town? He's just trying to do right by the city.
So these people will not stop believing in him. Like, his friends are there for him.
Yeah.
Like, I expected this mayor to be like, now, let's all just pass around a bucket of cyanide pills. Everybody take one. There's no sense in living in this town anymore.
Life is
meaningless. Mm-hmm. Thank you, Hunt.
The town rallies again until Hunt then gets up there and gives his speech and is honest with them that he lied. And he's, again, a very humble, very sweet speech because he tells them. Basically, he tells them, too, like, yeah, the Japanese do work better than us. They do. Like, we want to have a lot of time off, and we want to, and they just do. And I made a promise that, you know, whatever. He's honest with them.
Yeah.
Only his girlfriend appreciates it, though.
Right, because it is a great wide shot of this entire crowd. And after he's done talking, they all just turn around and hang their heads and walk away.
They're like, no, uh-uh.
Yeah. Yeah, but after their big fight about that blonde lady who, oh, my God, I still
don't see
understand.
Her again.
I still don't get it. After they have that fight, he and Mimi Rogers finally make up.
Yes.
She believes in him or whatever. And then they almost run over Kaz. Apparently they've been driving all night because it's the next morning.
She goes to look for him because, remember, he's putting his head in the cannon. He's at the park because somebody put horse manure in his car, he says. And I love it. He's like, I don't... She's like, who would do that? He's like, I don't think a horse would do it. Then, so I think it's like the early morning hours that she picks him up. He's walking alone because then back at the factory, all the Japanese guys were going over the books. Mm-hmm. And one of the guys wants to leave because his wife's in labor. One of the Japanese guys wants to leave. But the big head honcho won't let him go. Right. And then this, they make some weird Looney Tunes joke. Yeah, remember? Because Kaz is like, you are all so Looney Tunes. Yeah. And then he goes, that's all, folks. Or no, he says, I don't know. He makes some
joke. You're all Looney Tunes. And the one guy's like, why are you talking American? Why are all of you speaking English right now? There is not an American in this room. You're just doing this for the audience right now.
But we appreciate it. Because otherwise you're not giving me subtitles or hieroglyphics.
So the Japanese guys are clearing out the factory. They're wheeling stuff out, you know, packing up to go. The American workers are sort of picketing, but not really. They're just kind of like hanging
out.
Yeah, they're just hanging out outside there. Hanging out, drinking beer at, you know, 9 a.m., whatever. Right. And Michael Keaton and Kaz, they had a big thing where they jump in the water and they're like, all right, we're going to go in. We're going to go in. And even the workers like, what are you doing? And they say, oh, we're going to build the cars. We're going to finish these 1,000 cars. Let's go in. Mm-hmm. The two of us, we're going to do it. And, you know, the Japanese guys are like, whatever. And so are the Americans. And we get a fun little montage of Kaz and Keaton just like, building cars.
I love it. He's like, what did that take us? 15, 20 minutes? He's like, 4 hours.
4 hours.
It took us 4 hours to build the one.
Well, we got this one done.
Yeah.
Yes. And all the workers are hemming and hawing about, should we go in and da da da. And George Wendt's still a jerk. He's like, he just wants to trick us into going in to make cars so that he'd look good to the Japanese. And finally, I think John Turturro wises up. He's like, let's just go in and make cars. And then the Japanese workers do too. Like, I love this because they're all working side by side.
Right.
Like, they're all just working together.
The Japanese workers take off their, or they're usually like in their lab coats. Yeah. And the one guy then wraps his necktie around his head like a bandana and starts dancing. So yeah, they're working together to make these last 1,000 pieces of tin crap. Yeah. But
pieces of tin crap. They really are.
They really are sad looking cars. But they work together, and it's by 7:30, I guess, in the AM, PM, I'm not sure.
I hope it's PM. I hope it's not AM.
I'm not sure. To get them all done. Yeah. And when the guy comes to check them, it's almost enough. They've got them all lined up outside.
Yeah.
And one of them has something peeling or chipping off it. The whole car doesn't count. I think they have like, they're out of six. They're six that they don't have.
Short.
Mm-hmm.
But even then, I think Kaz comes outside and he's like, well, we have more inside.
Right.
So these are ones that they're just finishing. And as we said earlier, Michael Keaton's like, oh, no, don't bolt stuff on or don't glue things or don't solder stuff. Just make it look like it's done.
Yeah.
And we'll just do that later. So it's okay. He's freaking out because the boss is like, no, you guys are short. You
know, he's kind of he's a stickler about it too. He's like, no, I wanted 15,000, and some of these are not up to my standards, because he opens the trunk of the one, like you said, and there's a guy inside. And then so he's not going to open. He's just like, no, I can't do it. You didn't make the cut. And Kaz tries to argue a little bit, but it doesn't really work. And then Keaton does another one of his impassioned sort of speeches about, well, we work together and I don't care. I've got the first car that was made in this factory. You can have the keys to that. I'm going to drive one of these cars because we made them together. It was a union that we did and da da da. And he goes in to start one of the cars, and it starts. Much to everyone's applause. Then as he tries to drive off, and the car just falls apart, literally. Like, It's like splats.
I like it even better if the car didn't start and he just made the noises with his mouth, like vroom.
Oh, yeah,
and then
yeah.
there's no floor, so he just starts moving with his
feet. But what about before, when they're doing the last touches on the six cars inside, Michael Keaton breaks the glass of the one car, and then he pretends that he's shining and cleaning glass. He's like, rawr, 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 rawr.
Pretty great.
Yeah.
All of this is for nothing. It's weird. It's a strange reversal that this boss has. It's a strange just change his mind. Like, a second ago, he was like, no, you're not going to do it. You're six short. And now suddenly, for no reason, he's like, nope, we're good. You guys can all keep your jobs. Everybody gets a raise. Everything's fantastic.
He was charmed. In the end, he was charmed by Michael Keaton, by Kaz, by their relationship. And, yeah, it all works out in the end. And everyone is happy.
And he does make his nephew or whatever...
He's the janitor.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Gives him the broom.
It ends. The ending is all of them doing jumping jacks.
Yeah, they're working out together.
They're working out. Mm-hmm. You know, they're in these uniform lines. Everything's great.
Yep.
The end. Problem solved.
There it is.
Gung ho. What'd you think?
I enjoyed it. I liked it. I thought that it was a little long, like some of the montage, baseball montage could have been cut back. I enjoy Michael Keaton, though, so I enjoyed it. It definitely wasn't my favorite movie that we've ever done. I'll probably forget it in a couple of weeks, but it was fun. I enjoyed it.
Yeah.
Yeah. How about you?
Yeah, I guess I feel the same. I feel like we watched so many goofy movies or so many just really bad movies that there's for all of them there's either just crazy stuff going on or something that is again crazy and unusual to talk about and to hold on to that with this legit movie I felt like it was kind of blah.
Yeah.
Like when it ended,
it was missing
that
great times, great movies pizzazz.
Right, exactly.
It's a good movie for what it was.
Fine.
Performances
yes.
were decent and everything.
Yes.
And it's, but yeah, it was missing that like extra quirkiness or extra just like layer of like what. And even they're funny. Both of the actors were very funny, but not like nothing over the top or nothing like Stallone and Dolly Parton. There wasn't that kind of a pairing, you know?
Right. Yeah,
so
like, everything about this, I was like, it's too polished or it's too refined. Or
but
it's
that's not
just,
a bad thing.
Just
that's
there.
Just
no,
not
it's
our
not a
podcast.
Bad thing because
yeah.
It's just it's a movie where at the end I went, well, that wasn't great, but it certainly wasn't bad.
No, yeah.
It was just a movie. It was something that I would have easily watched when I was younger if I just caught it on HBO. And I just would have been entertained and, like you said, forgot about it a few weeks later.
Right, right. I know that there's better Michael Keaton movies out there. But yeah, gung-ho. This was for what was it, American Car Workers Week?
National Auto Workers Week.
Oh, there you go. There you go.
Close enough.
So, yeah,
I mean,
it
cars
worked.
Cars are autos.
All right, well, there you have it. That was gung-ho, friends.
It was. Yes.
And we were kind of gung-ho about it. We were meh about it. What was your recommendation? Did you have one?
You know what? My recommendation, I was really trying to think. When you went to go calm your dog down, I was like, why am I not recommending a Japanese movie? I have so many.
Oh, yeah.
From,
you must have like a list.
I didn't do it. I am going to recommend a documentary.
Oh, about the auto industry?
No, close.
Oh, okay.
It's called Harlan County, USA.
Mm.
It is a documentary about like labor tensions in coal mining county in Kentucky. So coal miners in this Kentucky town join a union.
Right.
The company doesn't like this.
Mm-mm.
And they strike for more pay. And it's a whole to-do because then the mining company gets scab workers and then there's tension between the scabs and the guys that work there. One person is killed. It's a wonderful documentary because it was all filmed there while this was happening.
Do any of the miners do an interview in a pool while they're drunk?
I would love that. I wish. And why didn't I recommend this at the end of that? But anyway, no, it's a really, really great
documentary.
Sounds
really good, yeah. Harlan County.
Yeah, because it is cool. One of those things where I like those Ken Burns documentaries where it's like, oh, here's a 19-hour thing on the Civil War. But all of that is just found footage and still photos and stuff. But this is actually, the footage is there.
Wow.
This documentary was taking place at the time of the strike. So it's really good.
Awesome.
What about you?
Got a little lazy. I just went with
Michael
Keaton.
You just
going
to recommend your car? You're like, you know what?
My first car.
A pretty smooth ride.
If I tell you guys about my first car actually was an Isuzu iMark. I think there was only like 500 of them made in the whole United States.
Of that.
Exactly. It looked as shitty as the cars they were making in this movie. No, what movie I was going to recommend was the latest Michael Keaton movie that I had seen was the 2014, that Birdman movie. And I have to be honest, this is how lazy I am with my recommendation. I don't really remember a lot about the movie. I just remember that I did like it. And I was like, oh, this is a good Michael Keaton movie. So when I was like, oh, yeah, what's my recommendation? I went easy. I'm sorry.
No, and it
was a good movie. I don't remember why, but it was.
I think that is homework to the listeners. Yes. Watch Birdman and then tell Jamie why she likes it.
Why did I like it? Why was I into it?
You know what's funny? I liked it too. I don't remember it either.
Yeah.
So anyway, everybody, in 2 weeks, Jamie, do you know what time of year it is?
I don't actually. Okay, good.
Sorry, I meant to be very general with that. I should have said, do you know what season it is? It's summertime, and every summer since we've started doing this, we have done a camp movie.
Mm-hmm.
Since Space Camp, and who can forget Sleepaway Camp?
No,
and
we can't.
Then we did Dirty Dancing, which is kind of a camp movie. I think we bent the rules with that one a little bit. Last year we did Cheerleader Camp. Remember
That's
Cheerleader
right.
Camp?
Yes. Oh.
So I've realized that what we're doing is we seem to be – first of all, there's a lot of camp horror movies, and I'm trying to not do that every time. So we're trying to do that every other time.
Okay.
So since we just did Cheerleader Camp, we're not doing another scary murder camp movie.
No.
How would you feel about going to a party camp? We're going to watch a movie that I've never heard of called Party Camp. I don't know what it's about. I assume there's going to be excessive amounts of alcohol. Probably a lot of boobs, I'm assuming.
Yeah, I'm assuming some boob shots for party camp.
That's what we're going to do. You can find it on YouTube. I already checked on that.
Oh, okay, it is. Okay, so, good.
Yes,
thank you for that.
YouTube might be the only place you can find it.
Fair enough. All right, so party camp. It's a camp movie.
I think we've been doing this a little bit too long. We're at the hour 45-minute mark, and I guarantee you when I cut this down for the regular listener, it'll be like an hour.
Well, there you have it. There'll be a lot of Asian-Japanese discussion they will miss.
A lot. I mean, we really gave each other a history lesson and are still not quite sure.
Are you crazy?
That's a lot of good stuff there for the patrons. Maybe not for the listeners, but for the patrons.
For the patrons who are canceling their Patreons right now. Like, I don't need to hear this anymore.
Yeah, forget these two. Yikes.
Idiot.
She's got to get her dog under control before I pay anymore. I agree, guys.
Maybe you should all be patrons so we could get some dog obedience lessons in or something. Funnel the money that way.